Do. Alrighty, let's see. All right, people are still moseying on in. I'll give them a few more minutes.
Also, this says that applications will be available starting 1 week.
All right. Opened up the videos. I think most people are here, so we're gonna start. Let's do this. All right, everyone, how are you doing? So let's see. So last class we were discussing the different types of biochemical, geochemical cycles that are important to organisms in an environment, and how cycling of both energy and nutrients is very important for overall trophic stability, as well as in order to make sure that environments are recycled and sustainable over time. So we're going to talk about during the rest of this class, the last week and a half, talking about different roles that organisms can play, trying to touch on, we talked about we touched on plants and animals, but we're going to talk more about soil as well as overall structure, global change. And specifically today, we're going to talk about the role that prokaryotes, or these single-celled organisms, play in an environment, and what importance they have to all of those different cycles that we were talking about, right? And so prokaryotes are single-celled organisms. They do not have a distinct nucleus with a membrane, nor other specialized organelles. And so prokaryotes, protists, are, when we talk about bacteria, archaea, these other single-celled organisms that are a little bit more simple, at least in basic structure, to our own eukaryotic cells, right? So this includes things such as bacteria and archaea. Obviously, bacteria are very, very diverse, set of cells. We talked about them a little bit and the roles they play. I'm going to focus a little bit more today on archaea, as archaea, I think, are a little bit less well known amongst most people and scientists, because, one interesting thing is archaea, we haven't found any pathogenic versions of them, right? So no species of archaea infect human bodies and make us sick. So it's probably another reason you haven't heard about them overly much. But as we said, they all have this same basic structure, which is similar to our cells, in which they have, this membrane around them and cell wall. They have, however, no, separation between their genetic information and the rest of their cytoplasm, right? The big distinction is that us as eukaryotic cells have those S specialized organelles, including mitochondria and chloroplasts, but then also have our DNA separated from the rest. And so one thing that's really, really important and drives essentially the entire planet is the fact that bacteria, archaea, are diverse in their nutritional needs, as well as their different pathways that they do and their metabolic adaptations. And so prokaryotes have pretty much every job on the planet that you could possibly have in terms of chemical cycling. At some point, there's probably a prokaryote that's going to help and do that. And so You know, when we discuss species, we talk about different ideas, you know, organisms that reproduce via asexual reproduction and, you know, cloning, things like that are a little bit more complicated in order to tell, you know, when they become a new species exactly. And so generally, different species are characterized by the way they obtain energy and the way they use carbon in their environments. So their ecological niche, right? What are these organisms providing and what are they taking from their environment? And so cool thing is bacteria and archaea can do pretty much everything, right? And so their genetic variation is primarily based on this nutritional adaptations, right? What can they eat? Where can they live? You know, as we discussed with like electronegativity and oxygen and carbon dioxide, you know, certain organisms, you know, oxygen being so reactive, certain organisms need to make accommodations in order to have oxygen not kill them, right? In order for carbon dioxide not to take over their respiratory processes and things of that nature. And so these prokaryotes all like to live in particular environments. And so you have the phototrophs, which are, you know, the same term that we used for plants, right? Those organisms that are using the power of the sun, the energy of the sun, in order to create these carbon-based molecules, right? In order to create sugars. And then I touched on this last class a little bit, but talking about the idea of chemotrophs, right? The idea that you can also take this innate energy in molecules in certain chemical compositions, such as the energy that's coming off these sulfur vents and these different things, in order to make organic molecules in themselves, right? So they're both doing phototrophy and chemotrophy. Not only are prokaryotes doing that, but there's this idea of being autotrophs and being heterotrophs. And so autotrophs are organisms that only need a carbon source, right? If you are, say, taking in carbon dioxide, such as a plant, that allows you to make organic molecules. There are heterotrophs, which are organisms that need at least one organic molecule, right? They need to be given, say, glucose in order to make their organic compounds. So organisms that are making their own organic molecules via a carbon source, and those that need some other type of more complex organism. So I would like you to know the difference between phototrophs and chemotrophs, and then the difference between autotrophs and heterotrophs in that way. Because again, this is how these organisms are splitting apart, right? There are phototrophs who are autotrophs, there are phototrophs that are heterotrophs. There becomes a lot of complicated interactions between these. But, you know, at base, when we're looking at a phylogenetic tree, we're looking at these different organisms, right? We're up in this section up here of the phylogenetic tree, looking at these three, you know, domains of life. You have eukaryotic, so that's, you know, that includes fungi, animals, and plants. You know, if you look at this evolutionary tree, you can see that plants, fungi, and animals are up here, right? There's so much diversity in organisms at this lower end. And so, you know, we have this common ancestor. On the left, we have bacteria. So we have all of the cytobacteria, protobacteria that we were talking about, you know, all of these different types of bacteria. Then they split off and started, you know, the lineage of archaea. And so one thing that's important to note is that archaea are more closely related to eukaryotic cells than they are to bacterial cells. So even though they are also single-celled organisms that share all of these common traits, such as the absence of a nucleus, absence of these, you know, complex organelles, they're actually more closely related to eukaryotic cells, which is super interesting. And part of it is actually the structure of their cell wall. And so, you know, bacteria and archaea can hold very similar niches in the environment, but, you know, there are physical differences that separate the two. So, you know, as a quick touch on bacteria, they're larger than archaea in general. Single-celled organisms are usually 0.2 microns to 10 microns. So you can think of like a quarter to maybe a 15th of the size of a human hair in terms of thickness. And so, you know, the DNA for bacteria and archaea are stored in a plasma ring, right? So their DNA, instead of being wrapped up in these tight coils, are more in a circular type of fashion that exists in their cell, which allows them to be very easily accessible, right? The DNA in a bacteria cell can be replicated by ribosomes all at the same time. You can have 50 ribosomes all on this because your DNA is just open and it's constantly floating around the cytoplasm, right? Your cell then has a cell wall and then the cytoplasmic membrane, which we all know, you know, that the lipid bilayer. Then there are the ribosomes which are floating around. And then you have some type of often, you know, movement structures, right? You have cilia on the outside or perhaps a flagella so that the bacteria can move. Not all are movable. And then bacteria vary depending on, you know, their type of cell wall, you know. So gram-positive bacteria have a single cell wall that covers their plasma membrane, which helps to protect them, keeps them insulated. But when you look at what's known as a gram-negative bacteria, they actually have a plasma membrane, and then they have this outer membrane, and then this also cell wall layer. So they have a thicker cell wall. So the reason these organisms are known as gram-negative and gram-positive is simply because this is a method of scientists looking at them. We'll do what is known as a gram stain, in which we will inject a kind of fluorescent fluid that will go into the cell wall and kind of penetrate it. It goes into the cell membrane rather and colorizes it. For gram-negative bacteria, this double layer of their cell wall actually stops the this fluid from being trapped inside the cell wall. So they glow much less, if not at all, due to their excess membrane. And so there are natural variations in cell wall types and thicknesses. Obviously, this is because bacteria are acclimated to very different environments, right? Certain bacteria are going to need a thicker wall to keep oxygen out or to protect them from some type of, you know, natural antibiotic or other organisms around them. There are different reasons to evolve it, but there is a lot of diversity in bacteria, which is also why when we create antibiotics, we can create a lot of them to attack different aspects of the cell itself, right? When we create antibiotics, we want to create some type of chemical that can, say, attack the cell wall or attack the bacteria in a way that doesn't affect our own cells or doesn't affect them nearly as much, right? If you kill yourself in the process of trying to kill bacteria, it's not necessarily going to help you, right? Fun fact is that there's an idea of what's called biological dark matter. And this exists in numerous ways. But one way is that, you know, in the environment, there are all these bacteria that are doing all of these different autotrophy, chemotrophy, all of these different types of mechanisms. And that means they need specialized conditions. And so this dark matter is the idea that when we are trying to grow and look at organisms within an environment, especially single-celled organisms, we're not catching all of them, right? We're only growing in the lab the bacteria that can grow on agar plates, in oxygen, in a certain temperature and humidity, right? We're not creating these advanced micro environments that exist in the dirt or in the cells of another organism, right? And so we're incapable of growing roughly 99% of all bacteria that's found in the environment. We have genetic codes for some of them, things of that nature, but we don't necessarily know and we can't necessarily look at all of them. So I think that's just interesting. Going on to archaea, they're extremely small single-celled organisms. You know, up here it's saying that their upper limit is, you know, slightly bigger than bacteria, but generally speaking, they are much smaller, probably 0.1 microns. And so the reason they are distinct from both eukaryotic cells and bacteria cells is they have a distinct cell wall. And so their cell wall is constructed of isoprene instead of fatty acids. And so if you look at, say, this chemical structure here, these fatty acid side chains in bacteria and eukaryotes, you can see the structure is all of these single bonds. And you can see the base is very similar, but this is what's known as an ester bond, an ether bond in archaea. And so archaea have instead of having an oxygen here, they have a hydrogen, which allows them to instead make a double bond on this carbon instead of a single bond. And so this isoprene side chain is actually much more stable than that of our fatty acid side chain. So they have this double bonds that go through it. And so ironically enough, the cell walls are actually made of the same stuff that insect exoskeletons are made of. They actually are made of chitin. And so they are, you know, very similarly, oh wait, no, what am I talking about? I'm sorry. They're not made of chitin. Looks like an extra H on the, oh yeah, this, I guess this is, pressure against right this way, right? So they're made of isoprene. So they have a more stable, they have a more stable cell wall. And so, as I said, none of these are known as pathogens, which is really nice. None of those make us sick, which is really great because they're actually extremophiles. So there are extremophiles, which are organisms that can live in extreme environments in all the domains of life. But archaea are the ones who are most known for that. And so what I mean by that is that they live in extreme conditions such as temperature, acidity, and then, you know, different chemical concentrations, right? So archaea are really good at living in those thermal vents, right? In that extreme darkness, cold, low nutrient environments. But they also live in extremely hot areas like hot springs and Yellowstones that are, you know, that are incapable of us to sit in, right? They're just way too warm. Most cells will die, especially if they're there for prolonged periods of time. You have here, which are, you know, this beautiful lake is actually an acid lake. That's why it's so different, colorful, and archaea live in there. And so the one cool thing is archaea have weird shapes. Like they come in these perfect circles or in triangles, very strange things. But the stability of their exoskeleton, I mean, of their cell wall, actually allows them to live in these extreme environments. And so, for instance, when you if you continue and go on to 108, you will do an experiment in which you take out DNA from some bacteria and then you run PCR on it. PCR is a process in which you can take a DNA sequence and you can replicate it many, many times. Essentially, you're forcing DNA replication on a very specific spot. But one thing to note is that in order to replicate DNA replication in a lab setting, we have to use extreme heat in order to tear apart the DNA. If we were to use our own DNA polymerase in order to copy this DNA, it would melt. It would denature, that protein structure would melt at too high of a temperature during PCR and would get destroyed and your DNA wouldn't get replicated. However, we actually found and we took DNA polymerase that exists from archaea. We took DNA polymerase from archaea that live in these high temperature environments. And so their DNA is naturally structured in order to be able to handle these high environments. And so we actually use their polymerase in order to amplify DNA in PCR. So like, not only are we learning about these organisms, but they're actually advancing our own scientific understanding of the environment. And so first video today is going to be on these extremophiles, just kind of looking at their environments that they utilize.
Intense heat, freezing cold, high acidity, and radioactivity. These harsh environments don't seem hospitable for life, but some organisms not only survive, but thrive under such extreme conditions. The name extremophile means extreme lover. These organisms live in exceptionally harsh environments, such as hot hydrothermal vents, or buried in rocks far beneath the Earth's surface. Extremophiles occur in all three domains of life: bacteria, archaea, and eukaryote. They range from the extreme heat-loving thermophiles, which feed off of inorganic chemicals and have special enzymes to survive high temperatures, to extreme cold-loving psychrophiles, which have evolved antifreeze proteins that help ensure their survival in some of the coldest waters on the planet. but the most extreme living things on Earth are tardigrades. Also known as water bears, these water-dwelling microanimals are polyextremophiles. This means they are capable of surviving multiple harsh conditions. They are nearly indestructible and have even survived the extreme conditions of outer space. Tardigrades have a unique adaptation that allows them to curl up into a dry, seemingly lifeless ball and slow down their metabolic rate. In this state, they can survive cold, dry environments like space for decades. Studying the adaptations of extremophiles may hold the key to solving many of Earth's problems. This includes the development of genetically based medications, producing new types of biofuels, and protecting people against radiation exposure. Extremophiles have opened our minds to the many possibilities of life and the environments that can support it. Understanding the limits of life in these extreme conditions on Earth may provide scientists with clues of how life could possibly exist elsewhere in the universe.
Oh, tardigrades? Yes, I love tardigrades. I think they're so cool. Their ability to exist in pretty much every environment, gamma radiation, solar, cosmic radiation, they're so impressive. I definitely went to an extremophiles exhibit and ranted about how nothing was extreme as tardigrades until the very end. They're super cool. But yeah, archaea are our domain of extremophiles, right? Obviously they live in other environments, but like they are the most consistently extremophile organisms in the environment. You know, we're going to talk about the role of like these different organisms in the sphere, right? So, you know, oxygen and metabolism, we already know about that. You know, we need oxygen for cellular respiration, though other organisms can be poisoned by it, right? And so we have aerobes, which are obligate aerobes. So those are organisms that need CO2 for their cellular respiration. And so they're incapable of growing without it. And then you have this fluctuative aerobes, which anaerobes, which are if oxygen is present, you know, they use oxygen if it's necessary, but if not, they can undergo fermentation or anaerobic respiration, right? So these are microbes that, you know, would be used in order to, you know, beer brewing process or things like that. Then you have these obligate anaerobes, so organisms that are straight up poisoned by oxygen, right? They live deeper in the ocean. They live, you know, underground in soil sediments where oxygen can't really penetrate as well. You know, as we learned, oxygen will take over their respiratory systems and will cause their cellular respiration to not function properly, right? It'll cause them to be inefficient. And so, right, we're talking about anaerobic respiration, you know, the creation of energy in the absence of oxygen. And so just like plants, you know, these different prokaryotes have different niches and will need varying levels of oxygen, which is again why, you know, that black DNA hole, right? There's a lot of these organisms we can't grow because most of our lab conditions have oxygen everywhere, right? So we're gonna be poisoning all those species that can't handle it. And so, you know, organisms that need to grow in the absence of oxygen, sometimes they'll use nitrogen ions or sulfate as their receptor, right? Oxygen is a little too electronegative. It's going to be taking it away. But ultimately, you know, we have these organisms that can undergo fermentation. They're creating these different chemicals in the absence of alcohol. Right. And so we have two groups. We have organisms that can survive with oxygen and those that cannot. Right. And those will be in very different environments. You then have to talk about the idea that there's, you know, these nitrogen cycles in the environment. Right. Everything needs nitrogen. Everything needs to be able to make amino acids and proteins. And so prokaryotes have access to nitrogen in many forms that humans can't take in. Right. As we discussed. Right. In the nitrogen cycle, you know, bacteria and protists and eukaryotes and things like that. I mean, prokaryotes are part of what's very important in the nitrogen cycle for taking atmospheric gaseous nitrogen and turning it into an organic form that other animals can use in an environment. So often prokaryotes are the ones that are providing the appropriate nitrogen to plants to kind of build up the rest of this community. And so obviously, as we said, nitrogen is necessary for a lot of things, specifically the creation of amino acid and other organic molecules. And so one thing that I want you to know that's very important is that cytobacteria convert atmospheric nitrogen into ammonia and other organic compounds. Ammonia just happens to be the one that's generally most useful to plants, but will vary in an environment, right? Through what is called nitrogen fixation. And so the cells take nitrogen from the air and then they fix it into an organic form. And then they allow that nitrogen in its organic form, in that form of ammonia or whatever, depending on what it's creating, to sit in the soil, right? During its metabolic processes, it's converting this nitrogen and getting energy from it, right? And so in some cases, you know, you have these organisms that are doing these anaerobic respiration, they're taking nitrogen, and then they're using those ions in order to create their sugars and other types of things, ammonia and things. And so there's this idea of metabolic cooperation. And so this is happening in prokaryotes between them, but also there's a lot of metabolic collaboration between prokaryotes and other organisms, right? So for instance, I'll talk about it later, but gut flora, you know, we are, our metabolism is based on what bacteria are and gut flora are able to break down, right? And so prokaryotes need to share environments with both us, but one another. And so they'll actually do a thing where they form biofilms. And so biofilms are, the attachment of a usually single species of bacteria. As that bacteria starts to mass produce, starts to create a hospital environment for itself, it will then actually, it'll call over secondary bacteria, or the secondary bacteria may be enticed by, it's called quorum sensing. Bacteria will release molecules, and essentially they can pick up on, like, it's like a calling card. Like when a bacteria gets here, we'll create a quorum that is like, oh, species A. And so bacteria will then group together and form a biofilm or a gelatinous gross mass of bacteria. And they will share, and cooperate resources one another. So for instance, you know, perhaps this secondary bacteria here is not good at dealing with oxygen, right? So you have this first settlement bacteria that's creating this matrix, this biofilm. Now it has this area that's covered in goop where there's a lower amount of oxygen, right? So now a secondary species can incorporate itself into this environment. And now that it has a microenvironment that's, you know, devoid of oxygen, it can start reproducing. And then perhaps it calls over a third species, or this group starts to mature. But, you know, for instance, you know, there's cooperation, right? So you have in this example here, you have these chains of bacteria, these protists who are connecting to one another. And so all of these cells are photosynthetic and they're creating their energy through the sun. However, they're incapable of getting enough nitrogen out of this, right? And so they need to have both nitrogen fixation and photosynthesis. But nitrogen fixation cannot be done at the same point as photosynthesis, right? If you have too much oxygen, it's gonna mess with this nitrogen fixation. And as you create so much nitrogen, you're gonna create this backlog that's gonna mess with your photosynthesis, right? You're gonna limit that. And so these bacteria will actually form isolated areas where this one, where these certain particular microbes are going to create a heterocyst, which actually protects them from the oxygen around them. And so they're going to create nitrogen, which they can share with all of these other photosynthetic cells in a way that is not nitrogen gas that, you know, hurts them. We have a question, which is, are these considered to be a step between single and multicellular life? I think that depends on your definition of it. I would say no, this is more of like a cooperation, but it can be very iffy in certain organisms, whether or not, you know, it's a single species of multiple single species or a single organism. Like for instance, man-o-wars, which you can think of as giant jellyfish, are actually the cooperation of like three different organisms living as one, you know, set colony organism. It can be very, very complicated. So I wouldn't say these are directly the single and multicellular life. It's more of symbiotic relationships and cooperation, I would say. And so, yeah, oxygen ruins nitrogen's fixation, thus these specialized cells need to isolate themselves. And so, you know, they're only undergoing nitrogen fixation. None of these other cells are doing that. They're instead doing photosynthesis, and then they're sharing both nitrogen and energy. And so, and so we have this idea of chemical recycling, right? Energy in an environment is always going up, and then in heat until you get to decomposition, in which it gets recycled. Chemicals, however, are constantly going in a cycle, right? We need these oxygen, nitrogen, and phosphorus in order to undergo metabolic processes. And so protists are important in all of these different cycles. Prokaryotes produce, you know, a lot of this. So for instance, you have the phytoplankton, which are autotrophs, which are making their energy from the sun. You then have them being eaten by zooplankton, in which case you have both of these organisms which are dying and leading to this waste and decomposing. That decomposition leads to bacteria, which releases nutrients. And so they're providing energy here. They are at a higher trophic level and eating other small organisms. They're then excreting important compounds, and then they're dying and returning that to the soil. I mean, into the water or soil through decomposition. And then there are other protists who are doing the decomposition, right? So they're acting in all of these different cycles and all these different levels. And so most of these organisms die. They're left as essentially it's like that feedback mechanism, right? Where more plants die and it allows for nutrients to be restored to the soil, which will allows even more plants to grow. Similar idea with these protists. And so prokaryotes like fungus are really important for decomposition and actually really, really important for photosynthesis. They actually provide the majority of the of photosynthesis on the planet. And then, you know, you have these organisms that are sitting at the top, and then they're dying. Their bodies are then floating to the bottom of the sea. And so prokaryotes are actually how we get a lot of nutrients to the deepest portions of the deep sea, like areas that we can't see, areas that are not getting sunlight. These dead organisms float down there and actually provide a lot of carbon and associated nitrogen to those organisms on the seafloor. And so in terms of ecological interactions, prokaryotes do everything, right? So they do symbiosis, they do parasitism, they do mutualisms. You know, they're primary producers, so they make nutrients available in the environment to other organisms. Again, we talk about, you know, plants producing all this oxygen on Earth, but prokaryotes are really what do it. So they're doing nitrogen fixation, they're doing glucose production. They're creating sugars, they're creating nitrogen for other organisms, and then ultimately they're also creating oxygen through photosynthesis. And so they're taking atmospheric nitrogen, turning it into ammonia. They're taking sunlight and they're turning it into glucose. And so, you know, when you see an algae bloom, you're talking about protists. You're talking about photosynthetic protists that are floating in the water and absorbing oxygen. And so, you know, through photosynthesis, they're taking CO2 out of the air and the water, because, you know, this is not a single cycle, right? You have fish, that are taking oxygen out of the water, producing carbon dioxide, undergoing this respiration. The protists are then taking that carbon dioxide and fulfilling the cycle, you know, going back and using photosynthesis in that in order to do it. And so, you know, it's the same as trees, right? These prokaryotes are holding almost every environment possible on the environment, on the planet, right? They have all these different types of niches. And so there are way more bacteria than trees. And so, for instance, am I not sharing anymore? Oh my God. I'm having such a hard time with Zoom today. Right. And so we just have this little meme, right? So like everyone loves trees for producing oxygen, but no one ever talks about these phytoplankton, right? They produce 80% of all the oxygen on Earth. Obviously, we still need trees. We shouldn't be doing deforestation and stuff like that. But phytoplankton never, ever get, you know, unless you're talking to someone like Professor Schwartz, for instance, who really, really likes talking about protists and stuff. Many people don't give them the acknowledgement that they need, right? They're literally producing most of the oxygen on Earth, 80% of it, compared to trees. And so we should really care about these organisms. And so, as I said, you know, not only are these organisms providing all of these different, you know, nitrogen fixation, oxygen cycle, energy cycle, but bacteria also act as pathogens, right? So bacteria will infest our body, both positively and negative. As I said, archaea are known to be non-pathogenic. And so, you know, the ability of these organisms being very simple is that they are adaptable to many, many environments, including the human body. And so some of them can have negative effects and kill you. Other ones are positively helping us, such as our gut flora. And so one issue that we have in, say, a antibiotic standpoint is the fact that bacteria and archaea have very low generation times. You know, depending on the species of bacteria, they may reproduce one every couple minutes, one every couple hours, but, you know, that is substantially faster than, say, humans, which are, you know, one new person, maybe two every 9 months, generally speaking, right? And so these organisms have a short generation time, and so they evolve at an accelerated rate. And so, you know, as I said, we try to come up with antibiotics that won't just kill our cells, right? We need to have them that are specifically geared towards killing these invasive organisms. And so luckily they have a lot of different, you know, cell walls and other aspects that differentiate them from our cells. And so we try to come up with antibiotics. And one thing that's really cool actually is the first antibiotics were all created from natural systems. The first one, penicillin, was actually extracted from a fungi that actually infected a bacterial plate that a scientist was plating. And he realized the bacteria weren't growing around the fungi. And so he swabbed that area, realized that there was a chemical there, and that chemical is penicillin. And so we try to have these antibiotics, say, clog specific channels. Say, you know, if there's different protein channels on the surface, you might be able to do that. Breaking down the cell wall, or actually sometimes we have them invade some of these bacteria and then mess with, you know, their, as we talked about, you know, their ribosomes, right? Their ribosomes are different than ours. You know, they are highly conserved, but they are specific to bacteria compared to eukaryotes. And so we can attack that specific machinery, or we can attack certain other, you know, internal structures, such as, you know, incorporating something into a plasmid ring. But, you know, a general problem is that you feed an antibiotic to someone who's sick, you hopefully kill that, and then they survive. But bacteria can be, you know, very tricky. They can exchange genetic information with one another. They can also naturally evolve and get, you know, resistances to certain chemicals. So when you give, say, a mutant staph infection, something that's staphylococcus, which is can be immune to 40 different types of antibiotics, it ignores it and it just replicates, and that organism continues to build up in someone's body. And so, for instance, the one that is most well known is staphylococcus, or a staph infection, MRSA, which is the specific strain that has all of these resistances. This is an old, you know, chart, but if you look at it, MRSA is this blue one here, and it's looking at the percentage of antibiotics we have that it's resistant to. And you can see that particular species of it are resistant upwards of 60-70% of the antibiotics we have. Other species of bacteria are also getting antibiotic resistance. You know, as we clean hospitals, as we clean all of these areas, like obviously an hospital needs to be clean in order to keep patients from getting sick. But the problem is that you are then cleaning, say, staph infections with many, many types of bacteria, many types of chemicals over and over again. If even a single one of those organisms survives, it's going to reproduce. It's going to reproduce very fast. And then you have a population of organisms that are immune to that new resistance. And so the problem is not that some bacteria are getting some resistances. It's that certain species of bacteria are slowly building up many, many resistances. So for instance, in college, I had a friend who went in to get his tonsils removed from the hospital, and he actually wound up getting a staph infection in the process. So luckily with staph infections, you can only get it by touching the bacteria. They aren't very mobile. They aren't aerosolized. They aren't in an environment. And so unfortunately, it happened to be someone else in the hospital who was working on him had touched someone and then touched him. And so what happened was he actually had a big patch of black fungus that's or a bacteria that started growing on his cheek. And so they gave him antibiotics. It didn't seem to work. And so ultimately what they had to do was they actually had to go in and they had to cut into his cheek, and they actually had to remove all that bacteria physically because it was not going to go away on its own. They then gave him the most intense antibiotics they had. And those antibiotics actually wound up turning all of his bodily fluids bright yellow, like bright orange, sorry. So if you've ever seen like a really old Gatorade commercial where people are sweating like neon colors, that's when he cried, when he spit, when he sweat. All of his bodily fluids were neon, when he peed, were neon yellow. It looked like Gatorade. Neon orange, sorry. And that was the only way to get rid of these organisms. And so bacteria can have, you know, very positive placements in the environment, but they're so adaptable that they can even, you know, get into our bodies and have very, very serious issues. So I'm going to show a video of these scientists kind of looking at antibacterial resistance and how it builds up in a population. And to sue, I don't know if he sued. I'm not exactly sure what the malpractice and or appropriate response was by it. I just remember, you know, him crying and me being like, why are you crying orange? So I'm not sure. That would be nice though, right? If you get a little money for it.
How quickly bacteria become resistant to even the most powerful drugs. We visited Harvard University biologist Michael Bain. He showed us an experiment first done in the lab of Roy Cascione. On what looks like a miniature football field, Bain pours a solution containing ciprofloxacin, or Cipro, a broad-spectrum antibiotic.
This has no antibiotic.
This has no antibiotic.
This one?
This one has just over what the bacteria are able to survive.
It should kill them.
It should kill them.
The next pool?
10 times as much.
Okay.
100 times as much.
The center zone of the table contains 1,000 times more Cipro than bacteria should be able to survive. Then Baim drops E. coli bacteria at both ends of the table.
There are about 1 million bacteria in there.
Okay, in that little drop.
In that little drop. So the bacteria start at both sides and they race to the center.
In just a few days, some of the E. coli bacteria figure out how to resist the Cipro and survive in what should be a deadly environment.
And if you look very closely right here, they're starting to grow into the center.
Which is by far the strongest antibiotic.
By far the strongest.
Stronger than you would ever give to a patient.
Exactly.
And yet they're beginning to evolve, to mutate.
This is evolution happening. each one of these little things that you see on it, that's a mutant. That's a mutant that's developed resistance and started to grow.
That means that the E. coli has already outwitted Cipro.
In 12 days.
Each time we take an antibiotic, bacteria can develop the same kind of resistance in our bodies, which is why the overuse of the drugs is so dangerous. Americans are among the highest consumers of antibiotics in the world. More than 250 million prescriptions are written every year, one third of them unnecessary, according to the Centers for Disease Control.
Right, so bacteria are naturally going to reproduce. They're trying to survive in their environments. They're acclimating. You know, it could be something as simple as, you know, they create a, they evolve a pump or a, you know, a specific protein that allows, that doesn't allow, you know, that particular antibiotic to get into the cell, or perhaps all of the ones that have a receptor for that one die out. And so, you know, we can have this buildup in the environment just very naturally, and it happens so much faster, bacteria, because of their short generation times. And so, you know, that's part of the problem with antibiotics, is the fact that, you know, if you take antibiotics, you should take all of your treatment, right? Usually when you have broad spectrum antibiotics, it's multiple things made to kill a lot of different bacteria, because the hope is, I mean, the fear is that, you know, you have a single bacteria that survives your antibiotic in you. And then you have a species that is now a strain of it in your body that you may give to other people or bring around that may, you know, be resistant to that antibiotic now. And so, you know, this shouldn't happen that fast, but, you know, we're cleaning things constantly. We're constantly having sanitizers and antibiotics necessarily in hospitals and other clean room environments. My old grad school roommate works for NASA, and he right now is looking at a type of bacteria that's found in their clean rooms that actually eats bleach. It actually eats the ultraviolet, like the UV radiation and the bleach that they use to clean that room to survive. And so they have to come up with new cleaning procedures for that. And so, you know, antibiotic resistance can be transferred from, you know, something as simple as plasma transfer, which is bacteria can essentially create this plis, which is just a little, you know, kind of attachment disc that it'll rod that it'll use to interact other bacteria. And so what they'll do is they will create a mobile plasmid, which is a copy of their DNA of, say, that particular resistance that it sees that it needs in this environment. It will attach to another bacteria, and then it will use that mobile plasmid, and it will actually let that other bacteria create a copy of it. And so it will create a copy, and now you have not only this one bacteria that can reproduce and continuously produce this antibiotic resistance, but you also have the second species. This could be another species of bacteria, or it could be the same species, another organism has that DNA and it can now be passed on. You also have cases where bacteria can actually, through transformation, actually uptake free plasmids. So say this bacteria had this mobile plasmid and it died. This other bacteria near it might notice that and might absorb it and start taking its nutrients in. And in that process, it might take this DNA as well. And that will lead to the incorporation of that into its body. And so bacteria have so many cool creative ways of actually incorporating DNA into them and acclimating, not just through basic evolution. And so we can actually do this both naturally and artificially. So this is something that we can do, where we can actually take genes that we want and insert them into a bacteria or allow them access to it and hope that that bacteria takes into that cell. For instance, you know, we did this with E. coli and spider silk. There are companies that have put the protein creation sequence from spiders into bacteria, and those E. coli will naturally produce spider silk proteins, and then the scientists can take out those proteins and then use them to make our own synthetic silk. We're still working on it. It's not nearly as good as you know, as strong as natural silk, but you know, there are creative ways that we can use this, which is pretty cool. And then last but not least, you know, as just a quick aside, just, you know, we have these different gut flora, right? We talked about those symbiotic relationships between humans. There's also the symbiotic relationships between, say, cows and gut flora, right? Many animals have these relationships with bacteria in which, for instance, you know, food enters, good bacteria will break down that food into different nutrients and combinations that are a lot easier and smaller. If you remember, you know, we need these specialized digestive areas to break down specific chemicals, right? We need certain enzymes, we need certain things of that nature. Also, all of these molecules are too big for us to absorb generally into our cells. And so bacteria will break them into smaller, more absorbable components, which will then be absorbed into our bloodstream or any other particular part. And then also, you know, bacteria living on these surfaces will actually keep and help our keep our gut wall sit clean, right? These bacteria will live there and they will stop these buildup of things like tartar plaque, other chemicals that might not be good for us. You can kind of think of us in that way as a giant biofilm, right? We are a giant biofilm filled with tons and tons of bacteria. As Sarah just said, there are more bacterial cells in our body than actual human cells. We are utilizing these organisms in our environment as well as in our body. And again, we're a giant biofilm. And so we absorb these leftover wastes from these molecules. That's why, you know, when you take antibiotics, you're usually a little nauseous after, or honestly, if you ever, you know, have been, you know, drinking on a weekend, one reason you feel nauseous and maybe your digestion is bad is because when you put in alcohol, when you put in antibiotics, you're going to kill some species of these natural good flora, right? Antibiotics are not going to be able to kill only the good bad stuff, right? It's going to naturally kill some of this other things. And so when you do things like that, you get nauseous because this is out of whack. And there's actually been a lot of studies where scientists are doing things such as fecal transplants, where you can actually take gut flora from a healthy person and you can insert it and have someone take it as a probiotic into their body, and you can actually restore your natural flora using someone with healthy flora. And they've done this in mice, and it actually turns out that a big discrepancy between certain mice that are more skinny breeding versus more, you know, they have a little bit more fat on them. Part of this has to do with their natural gut flora, right? The compounds that they're able to break down, these skinny mice actually happen to have bacteria that can help break down more of these fats. And so those get removed from the body and don't get stored as much in the process. And so these organisms are doing a lot for us. And so it'll be interesting to see, you know, how commonplace and how much fecal transplants become a thing in terms of, you know, restoring proper gut flora and things like that. All right. So if you look through the video, the presentation, I ran out of time. There's a few other videos on some cool things on different aspects that prokaryotes do in the environment. But these are the last concept questions. And yeah, do we have any other questions on anything? Sorry, I talk so fast today. I'm a little frazzled.
I'm just curious if there's a specific day set for a final exam, because when I was checking the syllabus, I saw that it was to be determined.
Oh, did I not announce that? One second.
I could have missed
it. Was an email.
Yeah. I'm trying to remember exactly what I said in the email. It was the
27th.
All right. Yes.
There's an email on April 20th.
Uh, Oh, yeah, I don't send this to myself. All right, yes. So is the 27th. Like your other exams, you will have 24 hours to take it. Technically, your exam is, you have 2 hours to do it, so a little bit longer for your final. I'm not going to make it exceptionally longer. It should be very simple. In fact, I was doing your final. So the structure of the final is that you're going to have each unit is going to have essentially a page of questions, a few multiple choice, and some fill in the blank slash matching type of things. So they'll be primarily focused on each of those units. And then at the end, we will have two short answers for you to answer, one of which you get a choice of what you want to talk about from one of the units, and then the other more of a summation kind of question about the course. And that'll be the structure for it. But it shouldn't be longer than the other exam.
Thank you so much. I must have missed that email.
Any other questions?
Yeah, so you mentioned that the cyan antipyle detect everything neon like orange. Is it because it was very strong, or is it like after effects that continued on?
Oh, for the antibiotics? Yes, it was very, very strong. I'm not exactly sure of what in the chemical composition makes it that coloration or why, because it's very consistent. Tears, spit, like it's throughout all of the bodily things. But yeah, that's just an example of how intense it is. Yeah, just the color.
Is it like all bacteria this good at survival, or just some of them?
Oh, it's some of them. You know, these organisms they're all very adaptable, right? And their generation times allows that genetic change to occur more rapidly and to be spread in the population. So they're all kind of like that. I think it's more, I would say more hit or miss of whether or not they evolve that particular type of antibiotic, especially if you're trying to say, take multiple types of antibiotic, you know, that intense one that my friend had probably not only tried to break the cell wall, but it also probably tried to impede some type of metabolic function. And so you use multiple, you know, strategies in hope that both they get everything instead of, you know, leaving one particular organism to reproduce. So it'll really vary.
A lot of antibiotics, for example, will target the ribosome, prevent protein synthesis. And, you know, so there are ones that do that or target the cell wall. And again, often those cocktails will have a number of the antibiotics. Another way to think about like that bacteria being good at surviving, they're not necessarily any better or any worse than we are, but as Prof. Diaz was saying, they, you know, there are so many of them, right? So like if you grow like a flask of bacteria in the lab, there are millions and billions of bacteria and they double, they reproduce every 30 minutes. And so the random chance that they develop some, you know, random, again, accidental mutation, which is what these are, that confers an advantage isn't any greater, but they have many more opportunities. You just need one of them to do that. And then it duplicates and it can duplicate when the other ones can't. And it rapidly takes over.
Yeah, if you remember the video, he said there were about 1 million cells in that single drop that he placed, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, and if you take 108, you will do calculations in which you take a soil sample and you will then, you know, plate them out and you'll get up, you know, like 20 colonies of bacteria. But when you do the math of how many bacteria needed to be in your sample in order to grow those 20 colonies, you will find out that it's, you know, 5 × 10⁻¹⁵, right? There's just an overwhelming amount of bacteria in even the smallest sample of things.
Got it.
May I have a good day?
Take care. Do you have any questions, Avery? All right, I'm gonna stop sharing. Stop recording.